Hi, I'm Daniel Smith, the Southwest Regional Agronomist for the Nutrient Pest Management Program at University of Wisconsin-Madison campus. And today I'm going to talk about preventing cover crops from becoming your next weed problem. Cover crops are of increasing interest to many Wisconsin farmers and farmers in the upper Midwest region due to many agronomic benefits. While cover crops interest is increasing, there's also challenges to cover crop termination. A recent survey conducted by SARE and CITC and published in their 2015 cover crop annual report shows that about 5% of farmers are concerned that cover crops will become a weed the following year. Some of these other concerns that farmers have include no measurable economic return, selecting the right species, cover crop seeds costs, time and labor requirements are increased to manage these cover crops, and establishment. The same survey also asked farmers to identify their cover crop termination method, and about 5% identified mowing as their termination method, and almost 60% identified they used a herbicide. Tillage and roller crimping options were also identified in the survey, and about 25% selected cover crops that would winter kill. Don't let your cover crops become spring weeds, and if they're not managed properly, that they will become spring weeds and produce problems in the future. The first photo shows winter rye and annual ryegrass in the mature form in early May. The second photo shows that we easily controlled these with a herbicide application. These cover crops can also be controlled by a variety of options I'll show in the next few slides. Italian ryegrass, also known as annual ryegrass, is a concern in Wisconsin. Farmers are planting this species as a cover crop. However, in 14 states, it's shown resistance to 5 herbicide site of action groups. These are also states where some of the annual ryegrass seed is produced. So we should use annual ryegrass with caution and have a management plan to deal with any escapes that may occur from annual ryegrass. Cover crops produce seeds usually pretty quick in the spring, and they quickly flower and then produce viable seed. Cover crops can also overwinter from seed, and these include rye, buckwheat, and vetch. Buckwheat is a particular concern for seed production because it can produce seed in as little as 60 days from germination. And vetch should be of concern in no-till systems for both a management aspect for the residue, and it has a hard seed that can last in the soil seed bank for several years. The first photo shows mature winter rye seed head, and the second photo shows a mature annual ryegrass seed head. The Midwest Cover Crop Council has an online selection tool that we can use to select cover crops based on characteristics that we have, and this can give us a good idea of what cover crop species to select, and then we can look further into these species to see what kind of management they may include. So for this example, I pulled up Columbia County in Wisconsin. I selected my cash crop as corn grain with a planting date of April 30th. I have a harvest date of October 15th on well-drained soil, and I want a nitrogen scavenger, a soil builder, and then a weed fighter is my third goal. So I want to look in that October 15th window. In four Wisconsin, Columbia County, I see the oats is a good option, and winter rye may also be an option. But if I look at some of these other species, really planting that October 15th is just too late unless I do an interseeding or overseeding establishment method to get that crop out there earlier than fall harvest. Planting a cover crop too late in the season will essentially waste seed and money and time and effort of the farmer. So we want to properly select our cover crop species based on the crop that we're trying to match with it. We also want to consider when we're selecting our cover crop species if it will winter kill or not. And we have several species in Wisconsin that will always winter kill. We have a few that maybe will winter kill, and we have some that will always winter, overwinter. These species include winter wheat, winter rye, hairy vetch, red clover, and white clover. The ones that are maybe going to winter kill include annual ryegrass, rapeseed, crimson clover, and sweet clover. And these we should be concerned about and have a management plan to deal with in case they do overwinter. And then our most common cover crops that will winter kill include oats, radish, field pea, and cowpeas. When we look at some of these species that maybe will overwinter, annual ryegrass is a popular cover crop that may not always overwinter. In 2013 and 14 winter, I had a trial out to the Arlington Agricultural Research Station where I had multiple varieties of annual ryegrass. 3 out of the 4 varieties survived winter. The following year, I had the same trial and all the species winter killed. So it's important to understand what cover crops you're planting out in the field and if those species may or may not overwinter and have a management plan for that. This table identifies the recommended termination methods for non-legumes, brassicas, and legume cover crops. This table also identifies whether the cover crop will winter kill, if a roller crimper is a good termination option, mowing is a good termination option, tillage is an option, and the asterisk indicates that tillage may be needed for multiple passes to fully incorporate the cover crop to prevent future growth, and then what kind of herbicide we could potentially select to burn that cover crop down. When we select a herbicide to terminate a cover crop, there's several termination considerations that we should follow. We should always terminate our cover crop following a harvest if we're going to harvest our cover crop for forage. And this is because there's legal labeled restrictions between the time that we apply a herbicide and the time that we feed a cover crop. So we want to make sure that we follow all those labeled restrictions. In the next slide, I'll walk through some of those potential restrictions. We want to consider our cover crop species for grass, legume, and non-legumes, and mixtures all require different herbicides to be used to effectively terminate them, and we may need to use a mixture of herbicides to effectively terminate the different species plus any weeds that we may have growing within that cover crop. Cover crop growth stage is also an important consideration, and the taller the cover crop is, potentially the higher the rate of herbicide we may need to kill the cover crop. Matching our burn down product that we're going to apply to the herbicide to the cover crop species to the weed species that are present out in the field. And then we also should consider what crop we're going to plant following that cover crop to avoid any plant back restrictions. Weather conditions may play a role in how effective the herbicide is, and then whether we're using a contact or translocated herbicide may also affect efficacy. So when we look at weather and herbicides, we should be terminating our cover crops during a period of active growth. And this is determined by day and nighttime temperatures should be at least 55 degrees Fahrenheit in the day and 40 degrees Fahrenheit at night. And they should be above these temperatures for the past 3 days prior to and past herbicide application to allow that herbicide to take full effect. Application should also occur 4 hours prior to sunset. If we look at feeding our cover crops and using those for a forage crop, there's restrictions that we should be mindful of when it comes to pesticide applications. A cover crop we can define as when no biomass is harvested. However, the cover crop becomes a forage crop when biomass is harvested. And most pesticide labels do not have any information on cover crop data, only forage crop data. So we should plan for pesticide applications and restrictions. So these are two example herbicide labels we look at. And we should always remember that the herbicide label is the law, and it's a legal requirement that we follow these. The label can be used as a guide for cover crop establishment when there's no harvest being taken place, but when the cover crop is going to be harvested, it's a legal requirement that we follow. So if we look at the label on the left, we see that we cannot rotate to any of the crops rotated below for at least 12 months. Barley, oats, rye, or winter wheat may be planted 4.5 months following treatment. If we look at the second herbicide example, we come down to small grains other than wheat, and it has a typical rotation restriction of 11 months and 18 months if we use that highest rate of product. If we move on to an example and we look at establishing winter rye, we have two products that we're going to apply pre-emergence on May 1st. The first product allows us to wait 4.5 months. On September 15th, we can establish winter rye, and then the following spring, it's okay to harvest that for forage value. The second product, we're gonna apply the same on May 1st to a different field, but we have to wait 11 months if we wanna use that cover crop for forage crop value. However, it's still legal to plant that cover crop on September 15th, we just no longer have that forage harvest as an option. At this point, we'd also be taking a risk if there'd be any injury to that cover crop. That would be the liability of the farmer. So we would have to terminate that cover crop, and we'd have to wait until April 1st the following year to plant that same crop as a forage crop value. We look at several trials that we did at the Arlington Agriculture Research Station over the past few years to kind of dial in on the best termination practices for annual ryegrass and winter rye. These were randomized complete block studies that were replicated four times over 2 years to look at the efficacy of herbicide rate and timing on annual ryegrass and winter rye in a dairy forage system. It's important to note that annual ryegrass did not overwinter the second year of the study. So we look at this first table. This is 2014 and 2015 rileage harvest trial, dry biomass and percent green cover of winter rye 2 weeks after termination treatment at the Arlington Agricultural Research Station. Timing A was a mid-May timing, and timing B was a late timing at full enthesis of winter rye. We look at the harvest value. The harvest was done through a mechanical harvest where we mowed off the plots and raked off the biomass to simulate a forage harvest. And then glyphosate was applied at 32 fluid ounces per acre with a backpack sprayer. If we look at timing A, where we did not harvest and we only used the glyphosate application, we could say that we significantly terminated that cover crop, both winter rye and annual ryegrass. Now, if we want to move down and we want to just harvest that cover crop and see if we can effectively terminate that cover crop without any herbicide, we can look at our data to conclude that the cover crop biomass of both winter rye and annual ryegrass is decreased. However, annual rye will regrow very, very quickly after harvest, so we would need to have a second termination pass on annual ryegrass. The second timing, we did also conclude that harvest was an option. However, annual ryegrass quickly regrew after harvest, and harvesting plus glyphosate was effective at terminating both species. And the glyphosate was always applied post-termination of the mowing application. So we do not need all that biomass out in the field to have glyphosate work effectively on winter rye or annual ryegrass. That concludes that in a dairy system, we can go out and harvest these crops for forage value, and the same day we can go out and make a herbicide application and have full efficacy of the product under ideal weather conditions. When we look at several pictures, we can kind of see that regrowth. This is harvesting and then no glyphosate application 2 weeks after harvest. So we have a manageable amount of biomass left over in regrowth from winter rye. And in the back, we show annual ryegrass, and it regrew to almost the same height as it was prior to treatment. We move on to harvest plus glyphosate. We can see that very little residue was left in those plots, and we sprayed those the same day as we mowed those plots off. And we had great termination with no regrowth in those plots. And then finally, if we look at glyphosate alone, if we're not going to harvest those plots for glyphosate, if we're not going to harvest those plots for forage value, we just apply glyphosate to those. We're able to knock those cover crops down to a point where just a minor planter modification could easily plant through that residue. This trial also looked at the different rates of glyphosate. So we had rates and timing. So this slide shows that the glyphosate rate trial and percent cover means for winter rye and annual ryegrass species by timing for 2 weeks after termination at the Arlington Agricultural Research Station. We have our three timings. Timing A was early May, timing B was mid-May, and timing C was late May around full enthesis of winter rye. And we can see that our timings B and C were most effective at reducing that winter rye biomass and percent cover in those first 2 weeks. However, after 3 weeks, all the termination treatments effectively terminated winter rye. If we look at annual ryegrass, all three timings did a great job at controlling annual ryegrass. Moving on to look at herbicide rate a little bit more, the take-home message is we can use either rate, 16 or fluid ounces or 32 fluid ounces of glyphosate 4.5 pound acid equivalent formulation to effectively control winter rye and annual ryegrass. And we should select those rates based on other weeds present out in the field as well. So our take-home message for annual ryegrass is that it may require multiple applications of herbicide still if we're not targeting these species under ideal weather conditions. Tank mixes may antagonize control, and annual ryegrass may not always overwinter in Wisconsin. When we look at winter rye, a winter rye may also require multiple herbicide applications depending on when we select those timings and the weather conditions. Winter rye is always winter hardy in Wisconsin, so we should have a plan for the control. And typical control is desired prior to heading, but this is when it's more difficult to control. So we should consider our timing of herbicide application as a critical portion of this winter rye recommendation. We should also terminate following forage harvest in all cases. Cover crop termination and crop insurance are also important considerations. So we should always check our current Wisconsin In USDA NRCS guidelines for our crop insurance and cover crop termination guidelines, for non-irrigated fields currently, those rules require that cover crops be terminated within 5 days of planting the insured crop. And for irrigated fields, these rules require that the cover crop be terminated based on cropping system and conservation purpose, but prior to crop emergence. Always check your policy and ask questions to your crop insurance agent. We have a publication on the Nutrient Pest Management website that details our termination of winter rye and annual ryegrass using glyphosate trial methods and procedures, along with the complete data set for that trial. Another great resource is Managing Cover Crops Profitably. This is the third edition published by SAIR, and that goes into some detailed information about each species and how we should control that species, as well as some of the benefits of the species, and maybe even some of the problems that are associated with those species. So that's a great reference to refer to for more information on individual cover crops. And finally, we have a new website for cover crops in Wisconsin, and that can be found through the UW Extension webpage. And with that, that concludes my presentation on terminating cover crops and preventing cover crops from becoming future weed problems. And I'd welcome any questions at the following email and phone number.